Bleeding Burgundy Podcast, a Washington football podcast by fans for fans, with your hosts, Jesse Martin.
You want to play what? Okay. Say hello to my little friend.
John Taylor.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
And Keith Gray.
The king, your majesty.
And now here's your host, John Taylor.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to an unseasonably warm episode of the Bleeding Burgundy Podcast. I am your host, John. And we're getting a late start tonight because Jesse lost his internet. What the fuck's up with that?
Yeah, I don't know, man. We were on the Zoom meeting and just fucking went out.
Yeah, how many Cox trucks did you say were on your street?
I think, well, when I passed, there was, I think, about five of them. I only saw one.
So is that like the ice cream truck on your street? Do they like ring a bell? You come running out?
Pretty much. Yeah, I live in the sticks, in the boonies.
Big question.
Do you stay with the vanilla?
Do you stay with the vanilla or do you try the mocha every once
man,
in a while?
Man, all flavors are welcome in my household.
Ooh, well, let me tell you something. I bet you their push pop is not something you might be interested in, I would bet.
One thing I've gathered here is Jesse's not telling the truth. He has a Metro PCS package where he pays by the minute still.
Yeah, I ran out of minutes.
That's probably exactly what it is. And I'm joined by my sarcastic friend Keith over there, who, as you can see, is finally cleaned up because, good Lord, dude, you were looking a mess the last time we saw you.
Yes, he was.
I had a ball. The Miracle Whip Challenge was a gigantic success. Honestly, how many times did you actually vomit? How many times did you have to swallow it back down or spit it into that towel? You went through three towels.
Yeah, I threw up once in the towel.
One time, that's all?
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
That was towards the tail end.
So I'm betting this year when you're grilling your Bubba burgers and lighting the rest of your neighborhood on fire with those grease trap things, you're going to be putting some potted meat on top, aren't you?
No, sir. That was absolutely disgusting. Uh-huh. I think the combination of the sardines and the sauerkraut is what did it for me. That just enough was enough. I mean, that sauerkraut juice was like, it was like pouring down and getting into the corner of my mouth. There was no avoiding it. It was bad.
Wow. That's good. I'm glad we did that. I tell you what, if we were not in a virtual surrounding right now, I'd definitely give Jesse a high five.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, so do we have anything left that we want to talk about with the Miracle Whip Challenge? Is there anything left to talk about with the Miracle Whip Challenge? Like, what are we going to do next year?
I will say this. It needs to happen again, for one. Two, the pictures floating around of Keith looking like
they're great.
Pizza the Hut is amazing. And to everybody involved with the challenge, you know, big shout out to y'all again. It was a good time. I was in tears laughing.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Point. I had to take my glasses off and dry my eyes cause I couldn't see. it was fucking hilarious.
Well, I couldn't dry my eyes. They were completely covered the majority of the time, so I had no idea of your guys' face expression.
That was the best, because your wife, when she did the eggs, she kept coming up to the camera and showing them to us, and you're sitting there staring straight ahead like some dope. You can't see it, and then spam.
Your wife was amazing. And, you know, when you were complaining about something, she goes, "Shut up, you're being rude." or when you're throwing up.
I'm talking here.
Stop, you're being rude.
There's nothing worse than getting egged and not know that you're about to get egged.
I don't know, you laughed at that stuff. I thought you liked that pretty much.
No, I mean, it was funny because I know my wife, and you know, I knew that she couldn't wait to do something like that, and I suspected that it might happen. But the first time when she hit me in the head and it didn't crack, you know, that's when I started laughing, because I knew it was coming the second time. But
well, the best part was that we only sold six eggs, and she gave you the whole dozen, I think.
Yeah,
great. So that was pretty good. Good bonus. Yeah, Rachel was the star of the show. I enjoyed the shit out of that.
Yeah, and what was crazy too, like literally, I had to go take a shower, right? Obviously,
hope so.
And then I had to get dressed quickly because my son had that basketball game. That's why we did it so early. And I'm not kidding you when I'm sitting there and she's like, God, I can still smell us.
I'll bet.
She's like, I can still smell us. So then we asked the parents next to us, we're like, hey, we're not trying to be weird here, but do we have like a weird stench to us? And the one lady's like, yeah, I kind of smell sauerkraut. And I'm like, dang it. So we gave a quick rundown on what we did and all was well, but I literally had to come back home, take a shower. Then I'm sitting here that evening and I'm all, of course, you know, everything's dry. And, you know, the one thing I forgot to do was Q-tip my ears. So I'm sitting down I didn't think about it. And because I was in such a rush to get ready for basketball. And so sat down on the couch and it just something didn't feel right in my ear. So I started digging and it was literally cat food.
Oh,
those people sitting next to you at the basketball game were like, yeah, we smell something.
Yeah. Yeah, it was cat
food. Let me talk into your good ear.
Yeah, so it was rough, but they came out of both ears because then I ended up Q-tipping. I ended up Q-tipping and I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe I even went out in public with my ears like this.
She smells sauerkraut. I'm sure the sardine smell, the cat food smell, all of that within your hair, in your
those
pores.
Together were pretty rough.
No, so that's I would consider that a rousing success. Not only did we raise money for charity, we got Keith to throw up over himself, and we got his neighbors at a basketball game to think that he was an absolute fucking weirdo. Yeah. So it's a triple freaking, it's a triple crown.
Yep.
There you go.
Everybody got what they wanted.
Yeah, I sure did. I had a great time. And again, thanks to Ref the District for hosting that for us because that was fun.
Definitely.
He opened the door for us to use a new platform too, now that we kind of got to experience it, which is super cool. I think that's going to help with our show later on down the road.
I think so, because you ain't helping. I'm just kidding. Nobody else would sit there and take that the way that you did. So you were a very good sport in getting all that food thrown all over you, because I still, I'm looking at some of those pictures. Holy shit.
With the cheese, the cheese. That like molded everything together.
It tied the whole piece together, didn't it? It was just perfect. It was the right touch.
Well, then what was the worst was when, everything had was falling through the process and she's picking it all back up and dumping it on my head. It was like extra for no reason.
I thought one of the best lines of the whole show was, you've got all this stuff in your lap that's being wasted.
Yeah. Yeah, and we talked about that. A perfect opportunity for her to take a shot that she did not. But
she did not. Got to give her credit for that. But I'll tell you what, by the end, she had a good freaking looking pompadour on top of your head.
Mm-hmm.
That the strawberry frosting really, really gave it the mousse that it needed.
Yeah, it looked like it had period all over my face.
No, it looked like you had afterbirth all over your face. It looked like you were doing seriously.
God.
All right. Well, yeah, now we're gonna make
if you would even mention that word, I definitely would have thrown up even more. Disgusting.
Down for next year.
And afterbirth.
Fucking God, after you're so disgusting. All right, moving along. It was a good time for the kids.
It was.
For the kids.
Yes, it was. All right. Well, so then, what else do we have right now? There's absolutely nothing going on in the world of football.
Quarterback talk.
All kinds of rumors.
The crest talk.
The crest.
Yeah, you want to get into that? Let's get into the crest.
I mean, yeah, sure. We could get into it. You've got yourself a collector's item now.
I do. You know, yes, and the funny thing is there's some. You can still see some hatred from some people.
Sure.
That.
It's ridiculous.
Oh, I wonder what the people are feeling like who got the jackets now. They got incorrect dates. Look, at the end of, I don't even care. Like, I don't care that the dates are they're truly not incorrect.
Exactly.
It's just you would have to do some explain. No, they're not.
Yes,
they're technically not incorrect. Technically speaking, they're not.
Ever.
With this one, you have to tell a story. Why it's 92, why it's 84. You have to tell it. With the other dates, you don't have to tell anything. Everyone gets it. So it's whatever. Like, for me, I never cared to begin with. Like, because I think that the crest was truthfully the only thing that is really left that truly ties into the history of the Redskins. You
color.
Take away the color. I don't even think the color does anymore because we're so focused on burgundy and very little gold.
or mustard yellow.
There's not a whole lot of gold in it.
There's not. There's not. And so
has there ever have been, though?
Well, we had gold pants. We've always had gold piping around the numbers. No, there was gold in the helmet.
There's not. There was not too much gold. It's
but it was still their two main colors. And then I think the white just pretty much accent.
I think every team's got white. You know, that's just correct. That's just,
To have contrasting uniforms for TV.
Just really, I guess it's just really interesting when you compare all three jerseys, just how they're not cohesive. They're all different. And so I'm just trying to, I wish I understood their thought process on that. Like, I want to understand their reasoning behind that just for a wealth of information. Like, not that I would sit there and say, well, you guys are stupid for coming up, but to get back to the crest, me personally, I don't really care about the dates because I'm not looking at the Commanders as the Redskins anymore. I'm looking at the Commanders as this is a new team.
Well, then they shouldn't have any dates on there.
Sure.
Established 2022.
Sure, but what they're doing, it was appeasing to fans like myself and fans that are older than I am, thinking that this would hold us over. But now I look back on everything, John. I look back on everything. I almost wish, like, we'd have just retired it all.
Here's what I would say.
Let them be Commanders and let us come up with new traditions. And it's still in Washington, so it's still going to mean the same to the fans. And you just move on from it all. I mean, why are we hanging on to something that no one wants or that a lot of people didn't want? And I know that's weird because I'm flip-flopping now compared to the way that I felt 2 years ago.
I think everybody still wants that.
Still wants what?
The history of the team, to be able to have the route to the team.
I don't think you're going to have that, though. I don't think that they did a good job translating that into the new brand. The crest just isn't doing it for me. I'm sorry.
We haven't really. Well, I like the crest because I think it's an original idea. And
I agree.
The fact of the numbers is, 99% of the people that you talk to in the NFL, you know, the people that don't think so are the ones that are always on any social media going, actually, it's actually the game was played in 1983. But if you look at any Redskins fan, all right, you don't even have to be an old guy like me that remembers these games. All you need to do is know the history of your team. And you say the 1983 Redskins, man, it fucking hurts. It hurts. I don't want that number on my crest because that's a bad memory. We had a great offense and we got our asses kicked in that Super Bowl. And I don't care whether it happened in 1984 or not. You put the 1983 season on there. Anybody that knows anything about this team looks at it and goes, oh God. That's a hard one.
I mean, I get that. And I'm not disputing that. I understand the point of view. I don't think anyone's wrong in this case. I think that it looks better when you go by your theory of what you just said, or not theory, but what you said. I think that the majority of the fan base recognizes those numbers. We don't recognize 92. We played in, you know, Minnesota.
When did Doug Williams win the Super Bowl?
In 92. Right?
But Doug Williams is the 87 Super Bowl. I don't care whether it was 88 or not. It's 1987 season. There was a strike in the 87 season, right?
But let's also not act like that merchandise and things weren't produced that said the other years as well. I mean,
sure.
Wheaties, it was one of the most popular cereals to buy just for the pictures that they put on the box. And Wheaties is referencing them 1992 champions.
Well, I tell you, it's because Wheaties, for one thing, they can't make a cereal that doesn't turn into fucking cardboard paste in 10 seconds.
I mean, it's a terrible cereal, for sure.
It's a horrible cereal, and I don't care whether it was the Breakfast of Champions or not. You were a champion because you had to sprint to the fucking bathroom after you ate a bowl of that shit. The other thing about Wheaties is those boxes, when they told us that they were so collectible, I don't know, how much are they selling for?
Well, not anymore. I mean, I could get that Wheaties box on eBay for $15.
That's right. So they lied to us from the whole get-go. So how the fuck do we take Kellogg's goddamn word on any of it?
I just don't think it was as big a deal, but I also understand why people did. So that's my thought process. So for people that are like, oh, you know, because it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. If I wear that jacket out in the public, just because it's me, people are going to clown me for those years being wrong.
Well, fuck them. Here's what you ought to do.
And that's what I was saying. Fuck them. I don't really care because this shit was a gift. I didn't pay for it. You want the jacket, and you're going to have to pay $400 to get it now with the correct numbers. Have fun with that.
Now, what you ought to do is you ought to make yourself a fake email from Joey and print it out and show it to everybody that says, here's your collectibles edition. We're going to change it in 3 weeks. And this one's going to be worth $10,000 on eBay in 2 years. Congratulations.
No, and that's the way that I actually look at it, to be honest with you, because I no joke, that jacket is still in the box, sitting over here on the floor next to all my other Redskins memorabilia that I have. I haven't truly decided what I want to do with it. In the sense of it's been
motherfucker wears it to bed, you know that
bullshit. I did it for a picture, and then you're right, I did. I wore it to bed. I slept in it. But what my point is, and then I'm sure Jesse wants to chime in, but my point is, I haven't decided what I want to do. I know that right now it could make money for charity, and so I'm thinking like that is a great idea. But then the other thing I'm thinking is, they gave it to it as a gift. Like, that's kind of like not the right thing to do. So then what? Because honestly, if I wear this jacket, it would legitimately be only twice. And it would be an event that I attend where I'm going to see the people who gifted the jacket to me. Right. And because I don't wear varsity jackets anyways, period. But anyways, so I'm thinking maybe I do hold on to it because there is a story to be told here, and the story will be interesting 10 years from now, you know, not just, I keep thinking in my head, like I walk into Pawn Stars and then they film me and they give me the history lesson on, this is the reason why the jacket
walked into Pawn Stars.
And this I start showing rare them social that was media sent straight printouts. To Keith Gray. Yeah. I start showing them digital media printouts of the controversy behind the jacket and how it was only limited to certain people. And then the dates were wrong. And then 3 weeks later they come out. I mean, it's a fun story to tell. So it's almost like, I just want to keep the jacket in the box just to tell a story later on down the road.
And that's anyway, what you should do.
I'm going to give you my impression of the people that Keith is telling the story to. Ready? Hey buddy, you mind? I'm just trying to read the paper here.
Shut up. It'll be, listen, it's a collectible. I collect toys. I used to, I don't anymore. I used to collect toys.
What was the best toy you ever had?
The best toy I ever had was, I don't want to say it was the best because I had a lot. But Optimus Prime, the original in the box, mint condition.
Had the penis on it, right?
I mean, yes, but I didn't refer to it as the penis. Oh. John, you want to
round it off, dude.
I used to be a huge toy collector, and my point is you look for things that are wrong. Anything that had errors in them, they brought you more money because it was a limited production run. Well, that's what this jacket is. It's a limited production. It's going to be seen as errors because the team decided to change the dates. And yeah, maybe there's a little, there'll be a little bit of money into it, but I'll probably never sell it. But again, it's just a fun story to tell. That's all.
Well, we've heard it several times now.
Well, and you'll probably hear it on the next episode too.
I think we should. I think we should hear the story of the jacket as much as we possibly can.
I just know that when I get in
space, that you got yours first.
Right. And then when the next time Jesse and I stay in an Airbnb.
That's right.
Right. I'm not going to use his loofah. But I'll allow him to sleep in my jacket.
The woman will probably give you a discount. Oh, you're the man with the jacket.
So anyways, Jesse, would you like to comment on the crest?
Yeah, sure. Listen, I absolutely love the idea of the crest. It's probably my favorite part about this whole entire rebrand, because it's something different. No other team has it. And they changed the dates. I didn't even care when the dates were quote unquote wrong. Even though technically they were the right dates, because that was the Super Bowl year.
They were wrong.
But I didn't raise a bitch fit about it. But it was what it was. I was fine with it. I didn't really care. I like the looks of it. And it does, to me, in my opinion, tie the roots of this team to the past, and I commend them for that, along with the colors, burgundy and gold. Black, burgundy and gold now too as an alternate, but that, we've been, a lot of people have been clamoring for black alternate uniform for years now. I don't feel the same way as Keith, as you know, kind of, you know, wish they would just blow it up. To me, it would not make it my team. I think I said this, you know, when we first started talking about the rebrand, as you know, if they change the colors, right? If they change the colors,
there's nothing left.
Would be a total different team to me. I don't even know if I could.
It would
I could
be.
Root for it. I just it don't. I don't know.
Well, there's no other close way around.
They're adding silver and black to a jersey. I mean,
but. I'm silver. I don't know what you're talking about. Silver.
The white sleeves. The white jersey.
It looks. It's gold, but it's got, because of the light hits it, it's a metallic.
Okay. Well, that's
either way.
That's
it's light, still not.
It's a real pale yellow. Gold. It's that's a real lighting. Pale gold.
But the fact of the matter is, I think that crest is something that, you know, fans that's been fans of the team for a long time needs to hold on to, because that is our past, and that's given you know, tribute to our past. I heard an argument today against the crest, and it just made me shake my fucking head, man. Some guy said it was sent an email to Al Galdi on his podcast. If y'all don't listen to Al Galdi, y'all should. He's one of the good ones out there.
He is. I wouldn't listen because he had Tom Lavero on, though. When he's got Tom Lavero on, I'm
what do you mean? That's right. I'm welcoming him. Jesse's an idiot.
Could you imagine your speakers are going to crazy trying to get Tom Foyt and then Al Galdi's voice way down here.
The octaves are so different. But the guy said the crest was such a dumb idea because there's no room to put there's no foreshadowing, because you can't put any other dates for when they win any more Super Bowls.
I wonder if this guy realizes it's not actually made with a stone.
Yeah, that's exactly my thought. I'm like,
the image size can grow.
You can shrink the file. Yeah, you can do it.
And I think, you know, Al bringing that to like attention, you know, I'm sure he gets a lot of emails every day because he's one of the top podcasts, and not only in Washington football, but a football podcast around the world. A lot of people listen to his stuff, but for him just to read that out loud was kind of a troll in itself, because it's just such a fucking stupid argument. I mean, it's so easy. You can change the font. You can definitely add to the crest, and which that's something that's going to happen, and something that they can definitely do. You can change stuff in the crest. The crest is there to be able to manipulate and to change. And I think it's like I said before, it's my favorite part of the whole rebranding.
Back in
what
history,
I heard was Tom Lavero said on that show. Did you hear what he said?
This was.
Do you mind passing the donuts?
So the thing too that people need to realize is the crest. You know, it's the family crest. It's the history, right? And so when you think about in the olden days where that was, you know, how you were recognized, you know, your family tree or whatever the case may be, they would add stuff all the time because, you know, history has to grow within your crust. The
history changes. And it changes.
Correct. So the same thing's going to happen now. I have come to the conclusion that I am not interested in any merchandise that is purely just focused on the W. For one, that W is hideous on hats. It's too gigantic.
I like the hat. I think the hat looks sharp. I like the charcoal gray hat, and that's the one I'm going to order.
Well,
I got the black one.
I have not ordered any. I did see a gray hat.
No, of course not, because they'll send them to you for free.
No, they won't. Shut up. I mean, if I get it, I'll probably wear it for free.
You'll probably get one with an upside down W. Joey, be here.
Hey, Joey, if you're listening, I'd like a hat. Anyways, I would prefer not to wear the W hats, just because I'm not really a fan of the W. I don't hate it, but I don't like it. For me personally, I'd like to go with merchandise, especially on hats and merchandise that has the crest, because that is the last remaining thing that does tie the history. So when I'm mixing gear, it'll make sense to me. There is one hat that I saw that I don't think is out there. No one's posted it or yet, but it's actually a gray New Era cap that has the Commanders with the two lines. And I thought, hey, that's actually not bad either. For me personally, like, I can see why you guys would wear the W, but I've never truly represented Washington, right? It's just, not me. I don't live there. I have no ties, no connections. My tie and connection is the crest. So I've
lived here all my life and I can't stand go-go.
Well, I can't either. You know, it's not my thing, not my style, but I'm just saying for me on a personal standpoint, I do agree with Jesse. I do like the crest. I did not really care so much about the dates. But for me, I think my target in merchandise besides jerseys, my target in merchandise with the hats will be when they, you know, start developing, you know, hats with the crest on it. And I think that that's the last remaining true tie besides the burgundy color to the team. And I'm okay with that. But those big old W's, man, that's wild. And I don't know, understand why the t-shirts, I mean, they're making them where, I mean, the whole damn W, like,
I think, you know, on that point, Keith, I think, you know, is to focus on the Washington aspect.
They really don't have anything to do with Washington. It's just the central location.
Like, why so large? That's the same problem with your jersey where it says Commanders. Like, why does it have to be so large?
Like the idea of a black hat with the Commanders with the two lines around it. I kind of like that because for me, I like simplicity looks good in my opinion.
I agree. You know, but like I said, not everyone's going to share that same opinion for me, and that's okay. Like, if people like the W, that's okay. Mm-hmm. Wear the W hats.
It's all right. I mean, you know, now that you've mentioned it, I probably won't order one. So, Joey, you know, that $39 I was going to say, you can now blame that on Keith.
That's another problem. Dude, on, man. $38
for a hat.
For a hat. Like, I mean, what happened to 25? They used to be
25, 29 bucks. Yeah.
Has anybody tried to look at other teams' prices too on Fanatics?
Oh no, it's the same.
I'm sure it's the same. Yeah. It's just NFL and everything in general is going up through the roof. Yeah.
It's driven the same. It's not a Washington.
Yeah, that's what I mean. No. Like we got to stop blaming stuff. You know, when people see that, they're automatically blame the team, and it's not necessarily the case.
Well, they're idiots.
The fact of the matter is the whole NFL has priced itself almost away from the average fan. Did you see Super Bowl prices? The cheapest ticket I saw in the stadium was like $5,000, $3,500.
And it's been like that. It's been like that for quite a few years too.
Oh yeah.
It's like ridiculous prices.
Yeah. If you're a regular fan, you're not going to the Super Bowl. Unless you really want to drop $20,000.
Well, back when the Eagles hit the Super Bowl, my wife not to get into it, but she came into some inheritance money after her father passed away, you know, due to a lawsuit that they did. And so anyways, she had
died of a lawsuit?
Huh? That's a bad deal. No, he died and then they had a lawsuit No, you're fine. It's whatever. But I guess that was extra information I needed, but she had the money at the time and legit considered the high price then was $8,000 just to get there. And she literally considered because she had an astronomical amount of money at the age of 17 or 18 that, you know, 18-year-olds aren't thinking about the future. They're thinking about, and I mean, she actually was very responsible with the money until she started telling me about paying $8,000 for two tickets to go to a Super Bowl. I'm like, you're out of your mind. But I get it because it's like, and that's how they get away with it. Because how many times is your team going to make it there? I mean, we haven't seen back-to-back Super Bowl since 2004.
That's so true.
But so they get you in that sense of in the moment. It's worth.
Well, it's beyond that. It goes to everything. And now $39 for a ball cap.
I know. You know, people are buying the whole thing.
And you know, pricing is going up for everything anyway. You know, inflation's getting stupid. Yeah. But $39 for a freaking ball cap? I mean, come on. You still have the same goddamn Chinese guys making it. It's not like they asked for a raise. All right? Oh. You know? So, whatever. I know that for a fact there's a whole ton of freaking tractor trailers heading toward Washington. So put some hats on there, for God's sake.
So, no, it'll be Crest merchandise for me. And that's fine. And like I said, I wasn't trying to hop online.
With the Crest on that gray sweatshirt.
But see, I'm glad I didn't buy it for one, because once they started, so they did when they put it online, that was what they were going to send, was what the ones with the wrong dates. Mm-hmm. But then they saw all the uproar. So before they actually started shipping them out, they made the correction to not even show anything.
Yeah. And
so people were getting that. So now people have merchandise that is actually incomplete based upon a team not making the right decision in the first place. And here we are now, they're going to have merchandise with the correct stuff. and it is what it is. But that's why I didn't jump online right away, because all of this is new to all of us. And I just don't, me personally, I don't see the need. It's always going to be here now. Why are we running to an internet?
Because you have to be first. You have to be first.
For what? To have a big ass W on your hat?
Because then Dan Snyder will smile upon you, and you know, you'll be the best fan that there is. That anyway, speaking of Dan Snyder, we do need to move along, because I got about a half an hour left, and we still haven't even touched the trouble that Dan is in and all the shit that's going on surrounding that went around all through the Super Bowl weekends. And we haven't even talked about the Super Bowl, which was a pretty good game until the referees got involved in the end and got all ticky-tack about it.
Who cares?
Dude, there's no fucking way that goddamn linebacker is holding on that play coming across the middle. There's no fucking way. But anyway, so Dan would seem to be fucked right now, wouldn't you think?
I don't think so. I think this new lady coming up, you know, she helped out Urban Meyer. I think this is another ploy by the NFL.
She got Jerry Richardson out. You know, she's had some that they can point to and say she'll be fair, but yeah, she's also had a bunch where she's come down on the side of the wrong guys.
That's what I'm talking about. I think this is just for optics sake. She kind of looks like a female Joe Gibbs if you look at her like closely enough. She's got the Joe Gibbs smile. But I don't think this really is going to do anything. I think a lot of people are getting their hopes up, and I think it's a trap. And like I said, I've been saying, beating this drum all along, until there's concrete proof, like a video or something.
Well, there is a video. We just, you know, everybody keeps pointing at this video called The Good Bits that Dan had made for himself.
That's what we got to find. Listen, it. There's no proof. There's no proof that Dan had that made, though. There is no email. It's all hearsay. That's what I'm saying. Hearsay. This is all hearsay. Well, Jerry Richardson had freaking tapes.
Yeah, that's
freaking
true. That's
you know, there's nothing. And like I've been saying all along, as much as I want that weasel out, I just don't see it happening, man. Without a smoking gun.
Much as I fucking hate the bastard, like I said all along, what happens to one can happen to any of them, and there's no way that any of them are going to be able to say, "Well, I've never sexually harassed anybody." I would almost guarantee it.
Yeah, I think at this point, with the Dan scenario, nothing legally is going to force him out.
Congress getting involved might be interesting.
Well, and the story is going to keep pushing, and as long as it keeps going, I think what eventually could very well happen is you got to also think about their marriage. All right, Tanya and Dan, how much is this really affecting their marriage? And I mean, either way, they're going to walk away with a ton of money. So it's a matter of if this is still getting so bad next year, the year after, and it just continues and doesn't go away, eventually the human side, especially your wife, is going to say, I don't know, give me half of everything
and I'm out of here.
Well, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying more of, Dan, this isn't getting any better. We might want to think about taking a different road here.
Like for Dan, what is this even fun anymore for him?
That's what I'm asking. That's my point.
Is this even worth owning a team nowadays? Sell it, take your money, and
cash
go high.
Cash out and go. As far as Tanya is concerned, I'll throw this out there, and it's a realistic theory, but people are going to hate me for it. But money makes people into whores a lot, and that means men and women both. And a lot of people will stay married to a complete scumbag because he's got billions of dollars. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So I'm not saying that's what's really going on with them, because I have no idea or any proof about it. But I would suggest that a
$42 million in cash?
Yeah, in cash.
The most expensive house ever bought in the D.C. area.
So nothing's happening with their marriage.
I don't think so. And this is why I'm saying those marriages where they just stay in completely opposite rooms. It's like Jerry Jones's marriage. Jerry Jones has a happy marriage, but you know that motherfucker's philandering all over the place.
It's another reason why I say Dan's got no worries in the world. He just bought that fucking house.
I know.
Right. It's more of, is this fun for you anymore? Because this is constantly going on year after year after year. It has to be taking a mental toll on your marriage. And at some point, you're going to have to make a decision. Do I keep this team because I'm going to pass it down to my son? Because that very well could happen. Or is it not worth it? And I honestly think that it'll get to the point where if Dan himself is going to make the decision to step down and sell the team, or not step down, but just sell the team, it's going to be more because we're still losing. And that's going to pile, that's going to pile onto right. everything else. And there's nothing positive going on. And your wife is pretty much telling you, like, look, this isn't, you know, it's not going away. It's just going to continue to get worse the more you're here.
And get us out of it. Right. See, the losing, I don't think is going to bother him too much because he's gotten used to that and he's still making money hand
That's exactly my thought. I don't think losing cares. I don't think he cares about losing. I don't think he cares.
No, that's not going to force him out. That'll make him try harder.
Well, he definitely didn't care about the name because if he did, he would have fought for it.
Well, you know why he didn't freaking fight for it? Because he's he's been making money hand over fist, but I'm going to tell you. He lost so much money in the last 20 years with this team.
Well, it's the trademark issue was such a big deal, you know.
Yeah.
The trademark, I think, was really the nail in the coffin. And then all it took was, you know, a couple corporate companies. Well, and if you notice, too, the women have kind of, I think, have given up on the legal sense. And now they're attacking sponsors, not attacking, but they're putting the sponsors' feet to the fire now at this point. So they're trying to get them on the sponsorship, which they're taking the same action the way that people took the action of the name, you know, and they saw that that was successful. So they're hoping that they can make this final push to sponsors.
Well, they did get one. I mean, I wouldn't call it a major sponsor. I think it was something to do with medical bills.
Right. Joe Theismann's annual commercial on the radio.
And
I think Joe Theismann lost all rights to even talk anymore.
Dude, do you want to know that thing that you're talking about, the medical, they will review your medical bills for fraud. That's the whole thing of their company. Just as a general look at where we are as a society, we have a whole industry devoted to making sure you're not getting fucked by your doctors. Anyway, so what we ought to do is see if Jerry Jones has any comments to make about all of this shit, since Dan did throw him under the bus. Do we believe Dan leaked out the stuff about Jerry's hush money?
100%.
Yeah.
Good God, yeah.
I think so,
good
too.
God, yeah.
I had to take the heat.
Because they like Jerry, right? Jerry, the NFL likes Jerry, and Jerry puts more money into their pennies, into their coffers, than Dan does by far. They hate Dan. They like Jerry. So Dan went, well, you can't throw me out because the guy you like does the same stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Well, let's see if we can give old Jerry a call, see what he has to say about it.
Oh, he's just going to step on in here. I ain't bothering with the goddamn sound effects there, boys. How you doing?
What's going on, Jerry? How you doing there, buddy?
Off season's treating me just fine. I know it's probably cold and wet wherever the hell you are, but where I am, it's wet, boy, but it sure is hot.
Got a question for you.
Do you think
Dan leaked the story about your sex scandal?
Let me just say before you start, if you go on over to cowboyshop.com right now and you tap in the promo code Commander, we will give you a brand new free Dallas Cowboys NFC East Champions 2022 beanie. Now, you notice I said the name or the season wrong, right? That's just to show how stupid Dan Snyder is for putting the goddamn wrong dates on his stupid little crest that he's got there. And that's why I'm really kind of pissed off right now, Dan, for leaking about all my indiscretions in the past. Because let me tell you something. I find this very disturbing about the way that this country is going right now. Back in the good old days, we rich old men could do just whatever the hell we wanted. And goddamn it, that's the way it should be. That's what America was founded on. It's one of the main reasons to get rich. You can do whatever the hell you want, especially when it comes to the sexual matters. I mean, let's be honest, God dang it, if you could... That's why it's called being filthy rich. You can pretty much fuck anything you want. Men, women, endangered species. It don't make a goddamn difference.
Jerry, kids listen to our show, buddy.
Well, there's a goddamn problem right there, I would think, because I've heard that other potty mouth that you have on this show, and he's a single-cell idiot. Just to give you an idea of what I mean about what fun it is to be filthy rich. Me and John Mara, we did some ecstasy one time, and we played the old pig in a poke for a whole weekend with a hermaphrodite named George that we met at Roger Goodell's summer cookout. God damn, I tell you something else. We had us a blast. Now, John Mara, he's a skinny little prick, and that goes double for him, if you get my meaning. Look, getting laid's one of the top benefits of being a billionaire, and whatever you're doing pisses anybody off or happens to be illegal or anything like that, you can afford to pay what we call hush money. You familiar with the term hush money?
Yeah, is that where that, what was it, $2.5 million payment?
That's right, $2.5 million to tell people to quit spouting off their goddamn mouths and embarrassing me and everybody else involved. Now, I want you to know, I do not think it was the young lady who paid to leak this information. I have no proof that it was Dan, but let me just say that knowing Dan like I do, it is exactly the sort of low-down, cheap, and dirty trick that sneaky little shit-eating pipsqueak would do. And, of course, I say that with all due respect.
Interesting. Jerry.
Interesting.
What's your thoughts on how the Washington football team, now Commanders, which we'll get into that. We got a question for you on that as well.
By the way, that's very coincidental, because if you use the promo code Commanders over at DallasCowboysShop.com, we will give you a brand new NFC East Champions beanie of the Dallas Cowboys.
Wait a minute. I thought you were giving a 2020.
2022. We're going to put the date on there.
Yeah, 2022.
That's right. Because we've heard that the people in Washington that we're targeting right now, they really don't know the difference of what year is what. It doesn't make any difference to them.
How do you feel about the Commanders? How do you feel about the Commanders getting rid of the cheerleaders? You think, I mean, we have a dance squad. It's kind of the same thing.
You have a dance squad. I mean, look. Let's be clear and honest about things right here. This here is an entertainment business, okay? And if there's one way that you can entertain more people in this country than any other way, it's by giving them sex, violence, and beer. And we try to give them all three. Now, we got plenty of violence out there on the football field. We got beer flowing like just water down through the stadium. So we got to give them some sex, and that's where the cheerleaders come in. I mean, have you ever seen the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders there, Jimmy? Have you? Have you ever seen them?
Absolutely.
They are beautiful. They are the most beautiful.
Who's Jimmy?
Yeah, whoever, whichever one of you beautiful boys I'm talking to. I don't know. Jimmy, Skippy, Johnny, I don't care. It doesn't make any difference. Here's what you are. You're down underneath where I live, and that means I can call you whatever I want. And if you don't like it, some hush money might come your way. Now, look.
Well, I don't like it, so give me some hush money.
Well, we'll just have to talk about that. Most beautiful cheerleaders in the NFL belong to the Dallas Cowboys. I don't think there's any question about that, because we were the Mavericks. We were the Trailblazers. The Dallas Cowboys in the 1970s put forth this group of strippers, basically, out there on the field that was going to show just about everything that you could possibly imagine. Prior to the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders, your average NFL cheerleader looked like she should be waiting tables down at the Denny's. You follow what I'm saying? That's pretty much the type that you had there. The beehive hairdo, the extra pencil in the pocket and everything.
Yikes, Jerry, that's a little rough, don't you think?
Hey, you know what?
I've met some beautiful cheerleaders. They were nice women, Jerry. I think
from 1974, let me tell you something. There was a reason that they kept those skirts that long, and it wasn't because of anything that you had to be careful for the television, let me tell you.
Dang,
so people, Jerry, they want to complain and they want to say that, oh, the cheerleaders is too sexy. Listen, that's what a cheerleader's for, is to be sexy. And what else are they supposed to be? They ain't there to cheer, that's for goddamn sure. They's there to wiggle their butts and shake their boobies and sell posters and calendars. How many calendars do you think that their dance team's going to sell for old Dan? What are you going to put that fat boy you got in there in a bikini and say, hey, here's Miss October?
I mean, he's got moves, though.
He does for a big guy.
He's got some goddamn moves. Let me ask you this. You want to see him in a goddamn G-string? Hell no, you don't. No, you don't. You want to see some fine-looking women. That's why I say, if you go over to cowboyshop.com right now and you put in the promo code Commanders, we will send you not only a brand-new beanie, but we will also send you a 1997 edition of the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders calendar. Now, the dates are going to be all wrong, but I don't think that's going to make much difference for what you're going to be doing with it.
Jerry, let me ask you about the new name Commanders. Okay. Yeah, what do you, as a rival of the NFC East, feel about Washington's new brand?
Well, I'll tell you something right now. Dan has done fucked that franchise up so bad, it don't matter what you call them. I mean, goddammit, there's still a bunch of people there crying that it wasn't Red Wolves. I mean, get over yourselves from me. I feel your goddamn pain. And if you don't like the new name, well, you just come on over to cowboyshop.com and you type in the promo code Commanders, and I will send you a brand new beanie, a 1997 Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders calendar, and I will send you a golf bag that was once touched by Roger Staubach. How about that?
I mean, like, Jerry, I appreciate all this, but I don't know if I like you coming on our podcast, always trying to sell your merchandise. I mean,
I really don't know any other reason for me to want to come on your podcast, my boy.
Hey, got one more question for you, Dan.
Yes, sir.
Sorry, Jerry. All right. I get y'all mixed up sometimes.
I don't know how. So, one of us is a short little peepsqueak, and the other one of us is a fine virile man out on a ship somewhere in the Pacific Ocean with a whole bunch of Samoan girls running around topless on the poop deck.
This question is about the pipsqueak and all his legal trouble. And Congress has now gotten involved. They just had this round table. What do you make of all this hoopla?
Well, I'll be honest with you. If the Congress isn't going to do any more good, like continue to cut my taxes and make sure I don't pay anything, then I really don't see any reason for them to be continuing to go after Dan. Because, frankly, if they go after Dan, that means that they could come after me. And I've spread enough hush money around, which is plenty good and legal, that I shouldn't have to be messed with by anybody, especially that woman that's chairing that goddamn committee. I think I gave her $2.5 million to shut her mouth one time over a little situation that we had in a YMCA, but I ain't going to get into that. I think that Congress ought to get back to doing what Congress does, which is pretty much nothing. Just sit there and argue all goddamn day and quit wasting everybody's time.
Do you think the NFL is covering for Dan?
Of course we're covering for Dan. I mean, Jesus Christ, the man has a couple billion dollars, and I guarantee you that if he runs us out, or if we ran him out, he'd spend half of it just trying to make sure that everything that we've ever done comes out. And I'll tell you this, old John Mara, he's got a lot of stuff he don't want coming out. He was the one that knew the hermaphrodite's phone number. I ain't going to say anything else. that fella was something, or whatever he was. If you rolled him over, he was something completely different, but he was something.
Well, Jerry, I appreciate your time. I know that you're a busy guy, but...
not really. It's the goddamned off season, and I'm an old man on a ship. I'm having a great time.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, we're going to just go ahead and let you go, sir. I think you've answered all of our questions, and definitely always appreciate your time. Thanks for coming and talking with us.
You tell Pedro we said hi.
My grandmother loves you.
Captain Pedro, it's about time for him to turn the ship to get me a little bit more on sun on the left side here, because I don't want to get too tanned on the right. And as far as getting me a new drink, I think, my falafala, you go get me one. All right. See y'all later.
It's always talking to Jerry. You just never know what's going to come out of his
head. That guy's an idiot.
Well, I just want everybody to know that the person who does the voice has absolutely no responsibility for what is said. Because I don't believe any of that shit.
John, why is it? I don't understand. Why is it every time Jerry comes on, like, you never ask questions? We don't even see you.
I'm just in awe of his presence, and I'm just going to make sure I run the microphones properly so that we can catch every bit of wisdom that drops from his lips. Mm.
So we got combine is coming up soon. You guys interested in watching the combine?
No, not at all. I get a kick out of the people that do, though, because. Dude, you don't know what the fuck you're looking at. Who gives a shit, that guy? You know, you really don't give a fuck. Look, this guy can fucking jump 7 feet in the air. Whatever. He can run 4.2.
There's only one year that the combine has been exciting, and that was when that big man was running the 40 and his dong fell out of his pants.
That was pretty good. Yeah, he got a hard on while he was running down the field. I don't understand how that happens, but okay.
Bro, I don't know if that was a hard on. You can hear him on camera. My penis fell out of my shorts.
Yeah, I liked when Troy Apke ran the 40. Right, I have audio of this somewhere. Deion Sanders was doing the commentary, and he was all surprised. He can run. He can run. And I'm like, just go ahead and say he's white, and you're surprised. Right. He can run. He can't do anything else, but he can run. So Troy Apke is going to be a free agent this year. Are we worried about that? Are we going to franchise him? You know, Ron likes him.
Wait, what?
Yeah, exactly. I should smack myself for even having said it.
I didn't catch what you said. Seriously.
I said Troy Apke's going to be a free agent. You think we're going to franchise him?
Oh, good God.
Good God.
No, I don't, don't expect him to be back in the Burgundy and Gold. Patrick and a guy like Durin Jake, they don't need nobody to be successful. They're going to be successful no matter what
situation you place them in. Troy Apke. I'm ready to run. Why are you surprised, Dan?
Oh, you know why I'm surprised. I can't say it on TV.
Can't say it on TV.
This is the message I would like to give to everybody. Just relax. You see, this is how people really are. This is how we are, and it doesn't mean anything bad. It just means that, oh, wow, look at the white guy.
Not even remotely offended by that. Yeah. It's fucking hilarious. It's
just, yeah.
Dude, it's how people are, man. It's how we all are. You know, I'm sure we were all surprised. We were like, damn. Why do you think? Look, I'm going to tell you. Here's a secret. All of us white people, we're going to get us a Cooper Kupp jersey. We're getting a. Hey, look at the wide receiver. We're all going to get one.
God.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, you know what? Though people that are listening, they're getting the joke. So whatever.
Oh, that's what I said. Whatever. It's a joke. A joke. It's a joke.
That's Deion Sanders. He could run, run.
You don't like our joke? Kiss our ass.
That's right. Kiss my white ass. I don't think there's a secret that it's white, though. You can see my face, right? It's okay. It doesn't look much different. It's just little, the bumps are in the wrong place. That's all.
It's a little elaborated by mentioning.
So, I want to bring this to the conversation.
Yeah, bring it home, Jesse.
Thank you, Jesse. Oh, let me just mention we are the People's Podcast.
We are
People's Podcast.
There's a new name being floated around to possibly be the quarterback of the Washington Commanders, and that is Carson Wentz.
Oh, God, no.
What do you guys think of that?
Oh, sorry. I already gave you what I think. Oh, God, no.
Keith, you got a blackhead right there. Just
you too. Look at it. Jesus Christ, it's waving freckle. At me. That's winking at me.
What's the question about Carson Wentz?
I heard his name floated today, and I think
the Colts are going to cut him.
He's going to get cut.
And I'm sitting there thinking, I'm like, okay, if they went hard to go get him, they gave up a lot.
Yes, they did.
And after one season, I said, so why would we want to get him?
I don't know why fans of our team, they just chase the dumpster. The dumpster, and they don't look at anything like the expiration dates or anything. They just drink whatever they find in the dumpster. Look, Carson Wentz is not an old quarterback. He's not broken down. He's not an injury problem. I wouldn't say he's had some injuries, but I wouldn't say he's not like a guy that's got a million injuries. He can't freaking last the season. He just lasted the season with the Colts. So he's got an arm. They can't wait to get rid of him. And both of these teams, the Eagles paid like $31 million they took of a hit to get rid of him.
Yeah.
And the Colts are now going to, for one, they had a conditional pick traded for him that if they played him enough snaps, he would become a first. If they knew he was a problem, they would have benched him and not given up the first, but they did. So now they're giving up a first and they're going to have to pay like $22 million cap hit just to get rid of him. If that doesn't flag to you,
that's Frank Reich too. And him and Wentz were close. So listen,
that's his coach.
I can't do a Jimmy Garoppolo. I cannot do a Carson Wentz. I would pick Mitchell Trubisky over both.
I would too. I'm glad to see you're coming around. Guys, in the sense of it.
I'm just saying. I don't want either one of those. I'd rather not pay anything for a Mitch Trubisky. And maybe see what we got, maybe draft somebody.
And look at a draft.
Give up anything, give up, let alone a fucking first round pick for Jimmy Garoppolo. You can kiss my goddamn ass.
Yeah. So.
And what color is that ass, Jesse?
Pasty white.
So.
Pasty.
I have to backpedal a little bit here because last year I was on the Carson Wentz bandwagon, right? Because I was holding on to that successful season that he had with the Eagles. And I felt like that Mr. Wentz was disgruntled with the organization as to why he was out of there. There was just some weird stuff happening there in Philly. But anyways, and I really thought, man, maybe Carson Wentz, you know, maybe he can be good, you know, and we haven't seen it yet. Well, I'd like to think the Colts, I'd like to thank the Colts for giving him a try to show that he ain't a guy that we need, right? He already auditioned. We're good. Everything that you guys just mentioned is 100% facts and is why you don't go after a guy like that.
Right.
Now, with that being said, you know, you mentioned Mitch Trubisky, even Jimmy G, let's Mariota. Winston. At the end of the day, those guys are not taking us to the promised land. They're going to give us the same results. I don't care about stats. I'm talking win-loss record. They're going to give us the same results that a Taylor Heineke would give us. So
I think they're a little better than that.
What one game and still no playoffs?
One game. It depends.
Okay.
Depends on who you bring.
Two games.
In.
We go into the playoffs and we get bumped. It doesn't matter. Why spend your money on something that there's no guarantee there, right? And they're not really that much better. You know, they're going to give us a couple extra wins. Thank you. Thanks for the extra wins and the thump out of round one of playoffs, right? So why bother? You're going to get the same results from Taylor Heineke. So you definitely at this point, yes, you do. Yeah. Taylor, you go to the first round of the playoffs and lose. That's the same if we even make it to the playoffs with Taylor Heineke. And hold on a second. I'm back on the the Heineke bandwagon, not for him to start, but I definitely think he's getting more negative on him than positive, right? We all know the deficiencies. We've said it. We don't need to get into it. But also take a look. We went 7-10 with Heineke, right? We went 7-10. Look at the strength of the schedule.
Oh, yeah.
7-10, right? Yeah. Not terrible, to be honest with you. It's not the end of the world that we went 7-10 with that strength of the schedule. Now, if you take a look at this year's strength of schedule and the teams that we're going to be playing, that's the competition that a 7-9 team should be playing. So now my thought process is this. I'm not saying that we should, but this is worst case scenario. And it doesn't necessarily mean that we're all going to go into a grave and die because Taylor Heineke is our week one starter. What I'm saying is that why can't the man, if all else fails and we don't get the big swing that we're looking for, you roll with Taylor Heineke again this season. It's not the best. You could shake your head. It's not the best move. And hold on. And I'm not saying that we do this. I'm just saying we're not going anywhere by getting Trubisky. We're not going anywhere by getting Garoppolo. We're not going anywhere by getting Mariota. Okay, they're going to achieve the same results that Taylor Heineke can. So don't waste your time. Go draft your guy, right? Let your guy sit for a year. There's no reason, or at least half a season. If Heineke is stinking it up, then you bring your rookie in, and this is the guy that you ride with from now on. There's nothing wrong with this plan, right?
No, so I think there's logic there.
There's logic, and that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying it's what we should do. I'm just saying that to me is the best logic. We as fans may not like it, but that's something that we should heavily consider. And like I said, we have a true strength of schedule for a team with a 7-9 record.
Yeah, right.
That's it.
That's in our
so
favor.
It's not the end of the world if this happens. Is it something that I want to see? No. I'd rather us get Russell Wilson. I'd rather us go in the draft if we can't get Russell and have one of these rookie quarterbacks come in and be the guy. But guess what? There's no Joe Burrows in this draft. So we don't really know what we're getting out of the rookie class to start him week one.
Okay, hold on. I know we have to go in just a couple minutes. I'm going to make this real quick. One, we've already had the Taylor Heineke experience. Okay, we know what he has. We know his deficiencies. Two, you bring in a different quarterback if you can't make the big swing because you don't. There always could be circumstances why that Mariota didn't work in the first place or a Trubisky didn't work in the first place. Bring them in, try somebody out, try something new while you draft somebody. I do not under any circumstances. I do not want under any circumstances want Heineke under center week one. I don't.
Right.
Jesse, we've already seen that. We've already seen that. Bring somebody else in.
For what? My question to you, why? If we're going to get the same results that we will get out of Heineke, why would we spend money on a guy and bring him in? To what? Hope?
Those guys aren't going to cost any money.
You don't know whether or not a Trubisky.
I'm not talking about the money. I'm talking about win-loss.
look, all these guys were hyped up into top five picks. And for one, I think that Winston particularly can take you to the next level, maybe not a Super Bowl, but it, no matter what, any of these free agent quarterbacks you bring, Jimmy G, fuck it. I don't want to trade a thing for that guy. I don't want to trade anything for that guy because there's better quarterbacks in free agency. All right. Mariota is
would
better.
Be the only guy Winston that I would agree with. Jesse has
on. Winston has everything that you want. You just have to make sure his maturity has gone up. And I think it has. Last year before he got hurt, he was having a fine season. This dude has put up amazing seasons without even being able to see. I know that I've harped on this before, but when you realize that he couldn't see downfield and you realize he's throwing to a spot, that answers a lot of picks. He can't see the defense make adjustments when they're down there on the field. He's throwing to where he thinks the receiver's going to be. And the dude still threw for the eighth most yards in NFL history. So Winston, I think he can take you. But all of these guys, even if you pick up Winston, you have to consider a draft. The only thing that I would say, maybe they don't like any of these people in the draft. And if you do, if you don't like any people in the draft, you don't waste your top pick on one. You go get the middle linebacker out of Georgia, and then you sign a Trubisky, somebody that can take you a little further for a couple of years, and then maybe next year you make your draft pick.
What though? Like,
so that's why, because you can't do everything all at once.
I would take Trubisky over Heineke 10 times.
No, you take Winston over all of them because to me he has the highest ceiling out of all them trash ass quarterbacks, and he's not even that great either. Well, so if you wanted to go the route that Jesse's saying, Winston to me would be the only guy that you do that measurement with. But the Winston's thing is why?
Why not? Why
you can't do everything all at once.
You're going to get the same results.
Sign somebody. You're
so
not going to
bring a guy
in to
lose in
the
first
stadium.
Round of the playoffs.
You can't go to the season with only one quarterback on the roster.
Well, you got to get somebody. I understand that, and that's what you do. The case you go and draft someone. So there's your three, but. I mean, Heineke already knows the system. I don't like Heineke. I don't want him to be the week one starter, right? But
you
I'm just
bring
saying
somebody else.
So you got to bring what, a Band-Aid like Fitzpatrick? That worked out real well.
You cannot go in the same season with Heineke. You can't do it.
So you keep bringing in Band-Aids to achieve the same.
You keep
results.
Bringing in somebody until
this
something
is the problem.
Works.
Like this mentality to me is just strange because you're not winning anything any different with any of these other quarterbacks.
Hold on a second. We got to go because I think that's ridiculous because you don't know what these other fucking guys are going to bring in. You know what Heineke is. Heineke's been in this.
What if these other guys brought to their other teams, Jesse?
Well,
Trubisky went to the
playoffs.
He went to the playoffs, and what happened?
With a Matt Nagy offense, he's a young kid.
You're not looking at all the optics here. The optics here. There's different, just like a Ryan Tannehill when he started off when he was drafted. He was not very good in Miami when he went over to. Quarterbacks, when they go to new places, it can work out.
That's a very low percentage. I'd like you to give me another example of that being
successful
besides Tannehill. Give me another example.
It doesn't fucking matter.
Because it doesn't happen,
onto the market very much.
It doesn't happen. That's why.
Exactly what John
just said.
Exactly what John just said.
Everyone throws Tannehill in there but cannot come up with another name
where
this has been successful.
They don't hit the market.
They don't hit the mark because
I don't buy
high tier quarterbacks do not go on the market ever. They hardly ever do.
So then we shouldn't go for
second.
So
you should go and try a different quarterback until you fucking find one that hits plain.
Yeah, you find that
simple.
One in the draft then the move you make is you draft your guy and you start him week one then.
No, you don't. Well, not none
not
of these
even,
guys. Not
that?
In this
why?
This, this
not even
you're
so
gonna draft if you draft if you're gonna
How
pick
do you
up
know?
A Trubisky.
I'm gonna flip it on you. How do you know that no one in this draft class can actually start?
You don't
week
you
one?
Don't start these guys week one.
No one thought Herbert was gonna start when he was drafted.
No matter who you get, unless you get Russell Wilson, you're
no one thought
got
about
to
Russell
try
Wilson
to draft a quarterback. You have
and to Russell
try
Wilson
to draft.
Was drafted. Mahomes
listen,
was drafted.
Man, listen, dude, you're not fucking letting me talk, man. We gotta go.
You're gonna really get fucking mad about that because we're actually having a conversation.
What we'll do? We have to go. John
Goodbye.
Has to go.
Goodbye then.
In the.